During his 23 years in office, the Russian president has faced numerous challenges to his hold on power, but this time is different. The greatest risk he has ever faced throughout his tenure is posed by this menace. It is a breathtaking spectacle to watch the seemingly impenetrable facade of absolute control he has painstakingly maintained for so long now quickly crumble, leaving him exposed and defenseless. The president's dictatorial authority has been characterized for years by the false sense of untouchable power. His most valuable asset has been his skillfully built persona as an unstoppable leader, capturing both his admirers and his critics. This exact base of his power, however, suddenly cracks with surprising speed, leaving a path of doubt and instability in its wake. This phenomenon has far-reaching consequences that go beyond just political ones. It causes ripple effects across the country, shaking up both its institutions and society as a whole. The reality that the president's hold on power is in peril is being accepted by the populace after they had gotten accustomed to it. The Russian president finds himself at a critical crossroads as the appearance of total power fades. The outcome of his political career and the future of the country he has led for more than two decades will depend on how he responds to this existential test. The formerly unstoppable leader now faces the vulnerability of his power and must either find a means to assert it once more or suffer the repercussions of its degradation. The current situation has a strange weight to it because it embodies both inevitable change and impossibility. Only a tightly controlled bureaucracy, impenetrable to criticism like the Kremlin, could sustain such a horrifying event given the way the war has been handled. It becomes clear that this result was inevitable. The idea of impossibility also permeates the air when Putin's critics inexplicably vanish, perish in tragic accidents, or endure horrendous poisonings. However, a remarkable weekend occurs despite these circumstances, forcing the fifth largest army in the world to make a crucial choice. Using their guns against their own soldiers, or fratricide, becomes the only way to save the Moscow elite from impending collapse. The seriousness of this scenario stems from the possibility that they may be forced to use this extreme measure in order to maintain stability and escape disaster. The initial acts of defiance by Yevgeny Prigozhin, the leader of the Wagner Group, were frequently seen as a calculated move, a deliberate ploy by Putin to keep his military commanders on their toes, using a reliable ally as a vocal dissenter. This is because our perception of Putin as a cunning strategist has become so entrenched. The current state of affairs, however, dispels any notion that the Kremlin was behind this uprising, as Putin is forced to admit that he no longer has control over Rostov-on-Don, a crucial military bastion. Any remaining concerns about the Kremlin's involvement in this turmoil are put to rest by the plain facts in front of us. The acknowledgement that Putin, the personification of power, is no longer able to keep control of a crucial military hub is a devastating blow. It becomes clear how far things have gotten out of the Kremlin's management and control. The effects are significant. Putin's facade of infallibility is destroyed, exposing the boundaries of his authority and the pervasive divisions within his government. The carefully created narrative of Putin's constant supremacy is dismantled, and in its place is the sobering realization that forces beyond his control have manifested and are posing a threat to his grasp on power. These events compel us to reconsider how we see Putin's sway. The current situation dispels the idea of a meticulously staged charade and reveals a reality that is much more complex and uncertain, where even the most seasoned strategists may be caught off guard and forced to deal with unanticipated results. Wagner's troops are likely to have spent a significant amount of time precisely organizing various aspects of this uprising. Despite the Russian Ministry of Defense's denial, the rationale for their rebellion was sudden and urgent, a reported attack on a Wagner camp in the forest. It's interesting that this episode happened soon after Yevgeny Prigozhin gave a brilliant study that dissected the underlying causes of the war. The coincidence of Prigozhin's exposé and the claimed airstrike suggests that Wagner's members were involved in a well-planned attack. It implies a deliberate plan to take advantage of the incident's timing and shock factor in order to effectively stir up discontent and insurrection. This defiance's deliberate strategy and careful planning are on display in the way it was carried out. It emphasizes the idea that Wagner's units had long been creating the foundation in anticipation of the right time to attack Putin's authority. This series of incidents also shows the subtleties and complexities of the circumstance. It reveals the existence of numerous actors working in the background of the war, each with their own objectives. It casts doubt on the oversimplified theory that the Kremlin controls everything and raises the possibility of factionalism and conflicting interests inside the Russian military establishment. It becomes more and more clear that the uprising inside Wagner's ranks is not only a spontaneous outburst but a well-planned and executed maneuver, with significant ramifications for Putin's grasp on power, as these layers of deceit and intentional actions come to light. He did, however, speak partially honestly when discussing the tragic causes of the war. Neither was there any imminent NATO assault against Russia, nor were Russian citizens being persecuted. In order to shift responsibility away from Putin, his lie persisted in implying that the invasion strategy was conceived primarily by Russia's military command. It is noteworthy that Wagner's men quickly reassembled and pushed quickly in the direction of Rostov, a feat that is difficult to accomplish spontaneously in a single afternoon. This implies a degree of organization and coordination that suggests premeditation rather than a quick, spontaneous reaction. The idea of spontaneity is further undermined by the quickness and effectiveness with which they mobilized, which suggests a carefully thought out and organized operation. Prigozhin has openly criticized the Ministry of Defense for months, and he may have hoped to pressure Putin into changing the department's leadership. Putin's recent speech on Saturday morning, however, practically eliminated any such chance. The elite of Russia are now faced with an existential choice between the president's crumbling regime and the evil mercenary Frankenstein they hired to carry out their covert operations but who has since turned on them. The striking difference between these two choices creates a precarious situation where the future of Russia's ruling elite is in doubt, divided between a failing regime and the potentially disastrous effects of their own schemes. For the Russian military as well, this is a stark realization. In the past, even Prigozhin's moderate remarks would have spurred elite special forces to quickly capture him while they were hidden under balaclavas. The current situation, however, presents a different picture. Prigozhin is free to move around and publicly declares his desire to march to Moscow. The absence of the FSB's special forces begs the issue of whether they have been seriously depleted by the ongoing conflict, or if they are afraid to face their well-armed and experienced Wagner allies. The FSB's answer is unclear, which highlights the complicated dynamics at work and invites conjecture about the real state of affairs within the military and the interplay of allegiances among its ranks. The recent occurrences that expose Moscow's weaknesses are not one-off occurrences. The elite who surround Putin were startled by how readily their capital's defenses might be overcome just a few months ago when the Kremlin was the target of a drone attack. The rich Russian homes in the country were the subject of additional drone attacks in the days that followed. These subsequent events surely planted a seed of skepticism about Putin's capacity to keep a firm grip on power among the wealthy class. The events that took place on Friday dealt the Russian elite its last and ultimate blow. The scale of the uprising among Wagner's ranks and the loss of power over significant military bases support the idea that Putin's rule is in danger. As questions grow within the important and wealthy groups in Russia, the previously steadfast confidence in his leadership begins to wane. Beyond merely political issues, these events have far-reaching effects. The Russian wealthy will certainly experience major changes in their attitudes and behavior as a result of the uncertainty surrounding Putin's hold on power, which could have an impact on the stability and support that the president has relied upon. There is little doubt that the timing of this internal uprising among Russia's forces is cause for celebration in Ukraine, as it may tip the balance of the battle in Kiev's favor. However, both in Russia and elsewhere, history has demonstrated that uprisings rarely succeed in their stated goals. The overthrow of Tsar Nicholas II in 1917, which ultimately led to the Bolshevik Revolution, Lenin's ascension, and the creation of the Soviet Empire, is a good example. This serves as a sobering reminder that the course of such uprisings can change unexpectedly, having unintended effects and influencing the future in ways that may not be consistent with the rebellion's original objectives. Currently, there is a delicate balance between the chance of a smooth settlement and the possibility that something may go wrong. After reaching this crucial turning point, it is difficult to imagine a scenario in which Putin's regime can return to its prior zenith of power. The course of Putin's rule has been irrevocably altered by the events that have torn apart the illusion of unbroken power. From this point on, it is obvious that a return to the previous situation is improbable. The political landscape of Russia must be reconfigured since the underpinnings of authority have been severely rocked. There will inevitably be more upheaval and change. The future is unpredictable, with the possibility of both turmoil and revolutionary changes. This seismic upheaval will have wide-ranging effects on the political, social, and economic spheres of the country. Russia will likely change in the future as it navigates an era of change and ambiguity. As the dust settles, new dynamics will emerge, and the country will struggle to understand the significant ramifications of this pivotal time in its history.